great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madman, some say king. A wonder-working rebel priest. And Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free a soul from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price. Well, Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. The devil, you're done, you better start running. Well, Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Take him in as his friend betrayed him with a kiss. And there before the mocking crowd, like a lamb to the slaughter, didn't make a sound. That cross to Calvary, and he shed his blood to set us free. As the nails went in and the sky went dark, the redemption of the world was on his heart. But Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. And don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. And devil, you're done, you better start running. But Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Then he breathed his last and bowed his head. The Son of God and man was dead. With bloody hands, tears on their face, they laid him down inside that grave. But that wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. Let me tell you what happened next. The women came before the door to find that stone already gone. When they looked inside, the angel said, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's alive. He's alive, hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high, hallelujah, he's alive. He's alive, he's alive, hallelujah, he's alive. Give him praise, lift him high, hallelujah, he's alive. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Sunday is coming. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh. Now Jesus reigns upon that throne. All heaven sings to him alone. We watch and pray like a bride for a groom. Oh, church, arise, he's coming soon. Amen, amen. Jesus is alive. Welcome to Aloma Church. We're so glad you're with us this morning as we celebrate our risen Savior. The tomb is empty. And today we have hope. We have hope because Jesus is alive. See the tomb where he lay. Oh, see the stone rolled away. He is risen. He is risen. He's alive. We'll see his hands. We'll see his feet. Touch his scars and believe. He is risen. He is risen. He's alive. Oh, he's alive. Yes, he lives. He lives. All honor and power are his. All glory forever. Amen. Jesus lives. Jesus lives. Hear the shackles breaking free. We'll hear the song of the redeemed. He is moving, he is moving, he's alive. So take this freedom, take this love. And can you feel the rising up? He is here, he is here, he's alive. The work forever done, only by the blood, oh, it is finished. Yes, it is finished. Come on, choir, help me out. You took
all our shame.
You left it in the grave. Oh, we're forgiven. Yes, we are. We're forgiven.
Jesus is alive this morning. Well, welcome to Aloma Church. Please take a second and greet one another.
my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven, he rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar, for Christ our King. Return and robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
He has given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And all God's people said, amen. What a greater way to celebrate and praise the name of Jesus here this morning than to see 10 brothers and sisters in Christ walk through the waters of baptism. Amen. I want to introduce you first. This is Tessa Lumpkin. Tessa, is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes, Jesus is Lord.
Amen. Based upon your profession of faith, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ, raised to walk in newness of life. This is Tessa's daughter, Alana Green. Alana, is it your profession of faith that Jesus is Lord? Amen. Based upon your profession of faith, I baptize you, my sister, in the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this is Landon, Tessa's son. Landon, is your profession that Christ is your Savior and Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Based upon your profession, I baptize you, my brother. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's only one family. This is Bobby Lumpkin. Bobby, is it your profession of faith that Jesus is Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Based upon that profession, I baptize you, my brother. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Miss Rebecca. This is Rebecca Stevenson. Amen. Rebecca, is it your testimony that Jesus has saved you and he's Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Based upon that profession, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. This is Chanel Clairvaux. Chanel, is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Amen. Based upon that profession, my brother, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen, brother. And this is Stevenson Toussaint. Stevenson, is it your testimony that Jesus is Lord of life? Amen. Based upon that profession, I baptize you, my brother. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen, brother. Now, this is Daniel and Anissa Moore. Daniel, is it your profession of faith that Jesus is Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Based upon that profession, my brother, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You want to stay here? This is his wife, Anissa. Anissa, have you trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Amen. Based upon that profession, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Great job. Great job. Amen. And I want to introduce this next two. This is Josh Ingram. He is one of our ordained deacons here. And he has been testifying and sharing the gospel with his son, Jace Ingram, for many years now. And Jace, on Good Friday, gave his heart and life to Jesus. And he's here. Jace, is it your amen. Is it your testimony that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior? Amen. Based upon that profession, my brother, we baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Oh, praise the name, yeah. Oh, Lord. Come on, let's give him praise. He's worthy, yes. Oh, praise the name. Oh, of the Lord. Thou art that sings my soul, and then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. Yes, how great thou art. Come on, let's give him praise. You are great. You are great and you are mighty. Risen Savior. Jesus Christ, we honor you this morning. Wasn't that great? Come on, wasn't that awesome? It's what Easter's all about. Dead, and we come back to life because Jesus, because of the hope that we have in him. We're going to go into a time of prayer during this next song. We're going to continue to worship, and if you would like to come to the steps and just have a time between you and the Lord, you are more than welcome. The risen Savior is in the house, and you may have a need this morning. You may have come to this place hopeless. When we read the story of Easter Sunday, the disciples, before they knew that the tomb was empty and that he had risen, they were a bit hopeless. Their master, their Savior, had died on Friday. There was confusion. They didn't really know what was going on. It was Mary and Peter and John got to the tomb, and it was empty. The Bible says that Mary went in, and she looked a couple times. She couldn't even believe it. But Jesus appeared to her. He said, Mary. She said, Rabboni, my master, my Savior, you're alive. And so in the midst of the empty tomb, there is hope because Jesus is alive. And you might be in this place today, and you might feel a little empty. You might feel a little hopeless, but I want to tell you that today there is a hope. There is a hope that we can hold on to, and his name is Jesus Christ, and he is alive. He is alive. He is alive. Amen. And he loves you. So we're going to go into this time of prayer, and we invite you to come to the steps or right there where you're at. Kneel, or if you want to stand, we're going to worship our great God. Father, we love you this morning. And Father, we sing these songs and we sing about Easter, but we're so grateful, God. We're so grateful for the cross on Friday that forgives us of our sins. We're so grateful for the blood that cleanses us. The chastisement of our peace was upon you. Every stripe that you went through heals us. And we're so grateful, Father. We're so grateful for the cross. But this morning, we're so grateful for the empty tomb because there's hope. There's hope because you're alive, because you overcame death, hell, and the grave. Because you overcame, we have life and that more abundantly, Jesus. We're so grateful this morning with everything within us. We are so grateful, Lord. We honor you with our praise this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You're welcome to come and pray or remain standing as we worship.
The name above all names, Jesus. The cross still stands, the blood still flows, the work is finished, and hell still knows that the grave is still empty, the stone is still rolled, and you're still high and lifted up, you're still seated on the throne. The blood still flows.
Above all names this morning, can we give him praise? Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, we honor you, Lord. Everything within us, God, every song that has been sung is to bring you glory. Now we pray for the message, God, as it brings for a pastor, Lord, anoint him, use him. May the word just touch our hearts, God. We honor you, Jesus. You're so awesome. You're so awesome. We love you with everything within us. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. God bless you. You may be seated.
Amen. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen, amen, and amen. If you would take your copy of God's word and join me in the Gospel of Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, over these past few days, starting on Good Friday, we've been answering some questions, and this will continue on into our new series beginning next week. And I want to invite you back next week as we begin to answer some questions that have been asked. And the first question that we're going to be answering next Sunday is, how do I deal with anxiety? Does that bother anybody? Absolutely. We all deal with the struggles and the stresses and the burdens of life. And so you'll want to come back next week as we answer from God's word these questions that we all have and that plague us. Beginning on Good Friday, we asked the question, why the cross? Why the blood? Why did Jesus have to die? Well, today we come to the empty tomb. And we want to answer this question that some may be asking today, what is the big deal about Easter? What's the big deal about the resurrection? My goal today is not to give an apologetic or to prove the resurrection, but to answer why the resurrection. Why does it matter that Jesus did not stay dead, but Jesus arose? Well, it matters a lot. And let's go to God's word and see the answer. It is our custom to stand in the honor of reading God's word. So if you would, please stand with me. I'll be reading from the New King James, but you follow along in your translation as I read from mine. Luke chapter 24, beginning in verse number 1. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales, and they did not believe them. But Peter arose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. Father, we thank you for the blessing of your word. We thank you for the blessing of sending your Son, your only begotten Son, into this world to die a cruel death, to stand in our place, and then to be resurrected to life. We thank you for the blessing and the promise that you've given to us, that whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And Lord, we pray for those who don't know you today, that today would be the day of salvation. And Father, for those of us that call you Lord, that call you Savior, that we have been found, Lord, may our faith be even strengthened today, being in your presence. We pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, and all of God's people said, amen. Please be seated. Our main idea this morning is this: because Jesus is alive, we can have faith today and hope tomorrow. That's the answer to why the resurrection. Why is the resurrection important? Why does it matter that Jesus is alive? Well, the reason why it matters is because he's alive, we can have faith today and hope for tomorrow. As we saw on Good Friday, Jesus, the Son of God, physically died on that Roman cross. It wasn't a spiritual death, it was a physical death. His body ended, his life ended. His death, his blood, was payment for all mankind. Why do we need the payment of his blood? Because all of us have sinned against God. The Bible says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." And because of that, we have an eternal debt that we cannot pay against holy God. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin, what you do to work or to as a profession, what you earn is a wage. And what you and I have earned because of our life, because of our sin, the wages of our sin is death. That's why he died. He died to pay the payment He died to shed his blood. He died in my place and in your place. Condemned, he stood. But you see, the good news isn't simply that Jesus died and that he was buried. The exclamation point is that Jesus arose on the third day. God raised him to life. As he physically died, he was physically resurrected. And this allows us to have faith in him today. Think about this. Jesus did what he said he was going to do. Luke tells us in the passage of Scripture here that the angel said to the woman, don't you remember what he said to you in the Galilee when he was teaching you, when he was with you? Multiple times Jesus spoke of his death, and multiple times Jesus spoke of his resurrection. In the Gospel of Matthew, he mentions it three times. Why three? Because three is an important number in the Bible. Three is completion. So here we see Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew, in Matthew chapter 16, Matthew chapter 17, Matthew chapter 20, verbatim saying, I must go away, I must die, but 3 days later I will be resurrected from the dead. All three times Jesus said he would be killed, he would be placed into a tomb, but then he would be resurrected. On the first day of the week, what we call Sunday, following the Passover, 3 Jewish days from his death, Jesus did what he said he would do. He arose. He is the Messiah. He is the Christ, the Savior. And through him, and only through him, can we be saved from our sin. We're saved by trusting in him. We're saved by the good news, the gospel. Paul writes to the church in Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel that I preached to you, which also you received, in which you stand, by which you're being saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain, that Christ died for your sins, he was buried, and he rose again on the third day according to the scripture. Notice the gospel is not simply the death of Jesus or the burial of Jesus, but it's also the resurrection of Jesus. Yes, he died. Yes, he was buried, but he rose again. Why is this important? Because this is how we are saved of our sin, how we're saved from our sin. It's the picture of the death, burial, and resurrection. Baptism, what we just saw earlier in the service. Every one of those who went into the water, they showed us a picture. A sign, a symbol of what Christ did for every single one of us. As they went into that water is a picture of a watery grave. And just as Jesus died, physically died, and was buried, the people went into that water, and they were buried as Christ was buried. And then on the third day, we didn't leave them under there for 3 days, just until the bubble stopped. No, they go under. And then immediately they come back up. Why? Because it's the picture of the resurrection. It's the picture of the gospel. It's the picture of the complete gospel that we died in Christ, we were buried in Christ, and we are raised to newness of life in Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1:13 says, in him or in Jesus Christ, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having believed, you were marked in him with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. Don't you see that the way we are saved is by grace through faith, not of works. We're saved by faith, trusting in the completed work of Jesus. What is the completed work? He did not stay dead, but he is alive. Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to all who work. No, to all who believe. Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you work as hard as you can. No. That if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. You see, this is what the resurrection does. Resurrection gives us belief. It gives us faith. Because Jesus told us what was going to do. If Jesus was wrong, then he is not the one that we would believe. But because Jesus accurately said what was going to happen, and he did not stay dead, but he rose, and then he ascended, and he is alive forevermore at the right hand of the Father, he is the one that we can place our faith and our trust in. And if you've never believed Jesus, if you've never confessed Jesus, you never followed him, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. Come to him today. Because Jesus is alive, we can have faith today and hope tomorrow. Today, Resurrection Sunday, Easter Sunday, is a day that marks the greatest change for all of us. And I'm not talking about the kind of change that the President of the United States has just signed into law. Did you see that he pronounced that today of all days? He pronounced across the land. He said that today is Trans Visibility Day. Of all days. Blasphemy. Blasphemy. This is appalling. The only person that is to be visible on this day is Jesus. We are all broken people. All broken people. Every single human being, so many hurting. But it is not helpful on today of all days, it is not helpful to turn people's eyes away from their only hope. Our only hope is Jesus. And the way we have hope in Jesus is to have faith in Jesus. And today is the day that marks his resurrection. And because of today, we have faith and we have hope. Hope in him. And the faith and the hope that he offers, that is the change that we all need. I remember as a young man, 27 years ago, I was a 17-year-old boy. I'll help you with the math. I'm 44 years old. I was a senior in high school. I was raised around the things of God, raised in East Tennessee. I mean, it is not just the Bible Belt, it is the buckle of the Bible Belt. I was in church 9 months before I was born. I was, for those diehard Southern Baptists, I was in the RAs. I was in Bible drill. I went to VBS every summer as a kid. I memorized the scripture. I knew all 66 books of the Bible in order by the time I was 7 years old. And the reason why I memorized that is because they gave me candy to memorize it. But I had memorized so many verses of the Bible. I had this head knowledge. I even walked down the aisle of the First Baptist Church of Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, that red brick building with a black steeple that stands to this day. But what you don't understand is that I walked the aisle as a 7-year-old boy, and I didn't tell anybody at the time, but I walked down that aisle because the week before, my friend Jason walked down the aisle, and I thought, oh, that's cool. He walked down and got to talk to the preacher. Then the next week, he was baptized. So I said, I want to do that. So I walked down and told Preacher Cope, I'm coming down. And then the next week, I was in the baptistry. And I was just as lost when I went into that water as I was when I came up out of that water. Why? Because for me, there was a disconnect between Jesus being Lord and Jesus being my Lord. I knew the scripture. I could quote you John 3:16, John 3:17, John 3:18, because we learned that in Bible drill. I could walk you down the Roman road because I've been taught this. I could quote every book of the Bible in order, the word, the Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, I could do it all. But I didn't know Jesus. There was no conviction of sin. There was no desire to know him or to be in his word. And I am not suggesting that it is impossible for young children to follow Jesus. My wife followed Christ at a young age. Our oldest two, our oldest daughter, our oldest son followed Christ at a young age. Absolutely, that can happen. But for me, it took more years until I eventually understood that I was a sinner in need of a Savior. I was sitting in a little small Pentecostal church in Maryville, Tennessee. The church could probably fit on this stage, to be honest with you. And there, that Sunday, an evangelist, I didn't know what a revival was. We didn't have revivals back at our home church. But they had revivals almost every Sunday at the Pentecostal church. And this boy was scared. You put a Baptist in a Pentecostal church, I was scared. I sat back in the back row and I was going to run out. But that day before I got up and ran out, I heard the gospel. I heard that I was a sinner in need of a Savior. I heard of my need for Jesus. And on that day, I repented of my sin and I followed Christ as my Savior. How did that happen? Was it my good works? Was it my scripture memory? Was it all of the years that was dedicated? No, it was all because of faith. It was all faith, trusting in Jesus as my risen Lord. And I followed him. And the salvation that I received so many years ago, I still hold on to that same salvation today. And because of the faith that I had then, the faith in the risen Savior then, that gives me hope. You see, it changes your perspective. You realize that when you follow Jesus, that there is more to life than what we physically see, because now we're no longer living for this day. Now we're living for that day, because the faith I have in the risen Savior has given me a hope for where we're going in the future. You know that this world is not going to get any better, right? I hate to be the bearer of bad news if you thought, hey, things are going to get better. They're not. They're not. It's just going to get more ridiculous, more crazy. It's going to flip upside down on its head even more. And Jesus warned us, right? Jesus told us in John 16:33 that in this world we will have troubles. But he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome. He's overcome what? He's overcome sin. He overcame death. He overcame the grave. He overcame it all so that we can have hope in him. He's alive. He's alive. And because Jesus is alive, we can have faith today and hope for tomorrow. That's the answer to why. Why Easter? Why resurrection? Why did Jesus rise from the dead? It's so that we can have faith in the living. All humanity has faith in something. I don't care if you consider yourself an atheist, an agnostic, a Muslim, a Hindu. I don't care if you live 2,000 years ago or if you live however long the Lord tarries. Every single person has faith in something. Now, the vast majority of people have faith in things that are dead. Think about this. Whether we're talking about religion, name your religion. Their prophet's dead. Their hope, their faith is in something that is dead. You say, well, I'm an agnostic. I'm an atheist. I only believe in myself. Okay, the Bible says that you're dead. Well, wait a minute, I'm alive. No, you are dead, and you're spiritually speaking, you are dead, according to Scripture. The vast majority of people that live and have ever lived on the face of this earth, their faith is tied to something that is dead. Oh, Christian, but you and I. Our faith is not tied to something or someone who is dead. I've been to Israel many times, and I've stuck my head in that door many times, and every single time I see that he is not there, he is risen. Jesus is alive, and because our Savior is alive, it allows us to have a living faith and a living hope. Peter says it this way. Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1, he says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has born us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Yes. You know, friend, what I'm telling you is that the reason why the resurrection is important is because it is the only means in which we're saved. It is our only hope for eternity. And I want nothing more. I want nothing more than every single one of you, my friends who are here today. I want nothing more than for you to follow Christ. Don't be like me. As a 7-year-old boy, having all of this knowledge but walking away from Jesus. Don't be like me. Follow Christ. It's as simple. You say, what do I have to do? No. It's nothing that we can do. If you and I could somehow earn our way into heaven, then the cross and the resurrection are the colossal mistake. If there was another way, would the Father not have done that other way than to send his Son to die the cruel death that he died? But you see, there is no other way. There is no other way. Follow Christ today. I doubt I have to convince anybody here that you're a sinner. You may be a good person. I was a good person. I've never been drunk in my life. I had never done an illegal drug in my life. I was a good kid, relatively speaking, good. But I was lost. You see, our goodness are but filthy rags to a holy God. And in our goodness, we are still sinners. And because of that sin, going back to what we said at the very beginning of this message, the wages of sin has a price. That price requires death. And you can say, well, I'm going to take my chances. That's your choice. But you also have another choice. You have another choice to follow Christ today. And to have all of your sin forgiven. All of your debt paid in full in the person of Jesus Christ. A couple weeks ago, I was invited to the Central Florida Fair. And every year, Aloma Church has partners with a ministry that is evangelism for children. And we always partner at the fair. And with all of the things that are going on at the Central Florida Fair, we always have a booth there that oftentimes really focus more toward sharing the gospel with children through painting and the colors and the wordless book. But we also have adults there because as the children come in, we share the gospel with adults that come through. Well, this year when I was there, we saw and we talked to many people. There was a young man, I say young, he was mid-30s. His name was Daniel. Daniel came and he was a great guy. Just a very warm individual, a wonderful guy. He, his wife, his two precious daughters had come to Orlando. They were visiting Orlando. They live in Louisiana. And we were talking, we were striking up a conversation. He was an LSU fan. We didn't hold that against him. We were just talking and then the conversation shifted. And he was asked, as we were sharing the gospel, he was asked, what's preventing you from trusting in the gospel? What's preventing you? And he shared, I was raised in church and I was able to share my testimony of how I was raised in church, but I wasn't saved. And we asked him the question, what is preventing you from believing the gospel that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again? He said, nothing. And right there, on the pavement, with all of the carnival stuff going around, this young man bowed his head and followed Christ and repented of his sin and trusted Jesus as a Savior. His wife and two daughters were in the little booth, and they walk out, and he shares with his wife the decision that he had made to follow Christ. And her response, she said, I have been praying for this day for I can't remember how long. Church, friend, let me ask you a question. What is preventing you from following Jesus Christ? What is preventing you from trusting in the only hope that humanity has, our risen Savior? I can tell you right now that in almost 100% confidence, that there have been people praying for you and praying for this very moment right now. It's your decision. Will you follow him? I'm going to ask every head bowed and every eye closed across this room. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, I don't know if I'm saved. I want to know. I want to believe. I want my sins paid. I can see everything happening in the world. I can see my life, and I can see that I've not trusted Christ, and I want to. How do I do that? The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised from the dead, you shall be saved. So it's confession, and it's belief, it's faith. It means that you stop having faith in yourself or in whatever it is that you're having faith in for eternity, and you put your faith, you put your belief in Jesus Christ. Right now, in the quietness and the stillness of this room, you can follow Christ. You can pray. It's not the prayer that saves you. We're not saved by a prayer. We're saved by faith. But simple confession, not even out loud. God hears the very thoughts in the heart of men. But in your heart of hearts, if you want to follow Christ, in your heart of hearts right now, confess your sin before the Lord. Confess the fact that you're a sinner. Maybe you say something like this: Dear Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. Ask Him in your own words to forgive you of your sin. Ask Him to save you and the Holy Spirit to enable you to repent, to turn from that sin. Dear Lord Jesus, I ask for your forgiveness. I pray that you will save me. The best way I know how, I turn from that sin and I turn toward you, my risen Savior. Do you believe that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again? That's the gospel. Do you believe that Christ did that for you? That He paid your sin penalty in full? Confess it right now. Lord Jesus, I believe that you died, you were buried, and you rose again to give me life. Now, in your own words, I want you to thank Him for the salvation that He has given to you if you've trusted by faith. You say, Pastor, I don't feel any different. Shouldn't I feel something? No. Maybe you do, maybe you don't, but salvation is not based upon a feeling. Salvation is based upon a promise, the promise of Romans 10:13, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. In just a moment, I'm going to pray, and when I say amen, we're going to sing one stanza and one stanza only of a hymn. If you're here today, just like we did in the first service, and we had people come, I'm going to ask you, if this is the first time that you've prayed a prayer like that and you meant it, maybe you've prayed it many times, but this is the first time you meant it, and you say today, I know that by faith I've trusted Jesus, and I want to share this with somebody. You need to tell somebody. We're going to have leaders of our church, men and women, here in the front. One stanza and one stanza only. So when I say amen, I'm going to ask that we stand, and if you follow Christ, I want you to come. Dear Lord Jesus, I pray right now for those who have followed you. And Lord, that as you were there on that cross publicly, or may we declare our faith in you publicly, for we're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to all who believe. So Lord, we thank you for those in the first service, those who are here today, those who are online who followed you and prayed to follow you as Savior. And now, Lord, we pray that the church will be able to partner with them on their new walk, their newfound walk with you. Lord, we give this to you in Christ's name. Amen. Come right now. Let's stand. Let's come.
Jesus, I surrender all. To Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily.
Friend, maybe you look at this and say, I don't know if I wanted to walk down front in front of all these people. I don't know. But know that at the end of this service, our ministers will be here. I'll be in the back. And make sure that you talk to somebody, because the important thing is now that you're on this new journey of faith, we want to be able to help you in this walk of faith. Hasn't it been great to be in the house of the Lord today for this Easter Sunday service? It's not over yet. We have one more song that I promise will stir your heart. But before we do that, let's be seated as we pray. Lord, we give this to you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that you did not stay dead. You rose on that third day to give us life, to give us salvation. You've given us hope. So Lord, no matter what it is that we face, no matter what we come against in this life, we hold on to our living hope, our living Savior, our living Lord. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Not a word was heard at the tomb that day. Just shuffling soldiers' feet as they guarded the grave. One day, 2 days, 3 days had passed. Could it be that Jesus had breathed his last?
Could it be that his Father had forsaken him? Turned his back on his Son, despising our sin. All hell seemed to whisper, forget him, he's dead. Then the Father looked down to his Son and said,
arise, my love. Arise, my love, the grave no longer has a hold on you. No more death's sting, no more suffering. Arise, arise, my love.
The earth trembled when the tomb began to shake. And like lightning from heaven, the stone was rolled away. And as dead men, the guards, they all stood there in fright. Oh, as the power of love displayed its might.
It filled the air, riding wings of wind. It was everywhere. The words all creation had been longing to hear, the sweet sound of victory, so loud and clear.
My love, arise, my love. The grave no longer has a hold on you. Oh, no more death sting. Oh, no more suffering. Where are your shackles?
Death.
Where is your sting?
Hell.
Oh, has been defeated. The grave could not hold the key.
Arise, my love.
Arise, my love. the grave no longer has a hold on you. No, no more, no more that sting, no more suffering. Arise,
arise,
arise. Amen, amen. He is risen. Jesus is risen. No more debt sting, no more suffering. Amen, amen. What a hope that we have today. And Jesus, we want to thank you so much for coming to Aloma Church this morning. If it's your first time or it's been a long time that you've been with us, you are our special guest. You're our honored guest, and we're so glad you're here. There's a QR code with your phone. If you could take a get that, and we can take a notice of your visit, or there is a card found in the seat back in front of you. Fill it out. Pastor's going to be right out there in Aloma Central. He would love to meet you. He has a gift for you. We are so honored that you're here today. We love you. We appreciate you. We have Wednesday night small groups, and next Sunday, we invite you back to our 9:30 or 11 o'clock service. Let's pray. Father, we love you this morning, and we thank you, God, for your goodness. We thank you for the hope that we have in Jesus. You are our living hope this morning. So we leave this place, God, not hopeless, but with our hearts full of hope, because you are alive and well. We honor you with everything within us. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. God bless you. See you next Sunday.